Good morning, church. Why don't you join us and sing this morning?
Oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
Morning, Jordantown. Well, here we are again with another snowy weekend. Wow, we go 3 years with hardly any snow, and now here it is, falling upon us again. Well, I'm excited to be here this morning and join you guys in this time of worship. But first off, we want to start out with just a couple of announcements, just to let you know what's going on here at the church. Our church office hours are Monday through Thursday, 9 to 3. I don't think we've announced that before. I just wanted to get that out there for you guys and let you know that those are the hours that Pastor Lewis will be here. Moving on, KFC, Kids for Christ. Of course, it was canceled again today with the snow, but we'll meet again on February 21st at 10:45. Don't forget Sunday morning Zoom Sunday School. Now, this is one that's going to happen whether it snows or sleets or rains. It's kind of like the mailman keeps coming all the time. So that's the way it is going to be for Zoom Sunday School. So you can count on that unless my internet service goes down. But ask me for any questions about that. Youth Remix will meet again next Sunday morning, February 14th, Valentine's Day. And it will be in the youth room and we'll start at 10:45. Speaking of the kids and youth, just to mention to you a couple of things we've got going on. We've got Goal to Goal, which is a new basketball goal we're trying to purchase. And the kids are bringing in things they want to sell, boots and soccer cleats and balls and clothing. And then I'm taking those things, selling them, and the money that's raised for that will go towards our new goal. Which, by the way, we're already about halfway there, so keep on bringing it in. Also, just to remind you that we are doing the new playground set. It has been brought to the church, of course, and when it warms up, we'll get that thing up. If you would like to donate and help us out with the cost of that, that would be greatly appreciated. Adult Sunday School, when it's not snowing, will meet the second and fourth Sunday mornings at 9:45. Continuing on with the parsonage, we are still working towards getting that finished up, and we are waiting for the cabinets and the flooring to arrive, as well as to get the drywall going. So hang with us on that. If you'd like to help, see Mike or Mike. And also, the drive-thru baby shower for the little Noel baby that'll be coming along, Ray Lee. That will be for Katie and her family on February the 20th, 1 to 3, here at the church. Miss Jessica and Christine both can give you information. As far as the community dinner, we're going to skip it in February, jump back in March. So hang on for details as that is coming up. And now, as we conclude our announcements, I want to just take a moment to lift the Lord up in prayer. Lord, I just pray right now, God, for our church, Jordantown Wesleyan Church. And Lord, I just pray that we will be a lighthouse in this community, Lord. Help us to have a vision and a mission to be a help to those around this area and beyond, Lord. And Father, I just want to thank you now for what you're going to do in advance. Lord, I know that your hand is upon us. And Lord, help us as the people of the church to do your will. Lord, help us to catch that vision and to see that ministry that you want us to do and to reach our community, Lord. I just pray that, God, people will come and be part of what's going on here at this church because of you. And Lord, that we will continue to see your kingdom grow. And Lord, I just thank you for your son who came and gave the ultimate sacrifice. In your name I pray this morning. Amen.
Let's continue to sing this morning.
Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount, how poor, there where the blood of God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Marvelous, matchless grace, freely bestowed on all who believe. You that are longing to see his face, will you this moment his grace receive? Grace, grace, God.
Righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names. ransom from heaven. Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. His body the bread, his blood the wine, broken and poured out, all for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel. Messiah, Lord of all. All our hope is in you. All our hope is in you. All the glory to you, God, the light of the world. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all.
Pray together. God Almighty, we come to you confessing our need for you, Lord. We are weary. We are weak. We are powerless, God, without you in our lives. We humble ourselves under the mighty hands of God, our Heavenly Father, now. We seek your grace, Lord. Cover our sins. Help us to turn our hearts to you. We confess, God, our need for you. Lord, I pray that you would empty us so that we would truly be yours, God, that you would bless us, Lord, to be a blessing to others. Lord, may they see our lives and say, surely God is good. Put your hand of blessing on us, Lord, that we might bless others. It's in the name of the Lord Jesus we pray. Amen. Hey, Jordantown, if you would, turn with me in your Bibles to Acts chapter 14. We'll be looking at verses 19 through 20. We're talking about resilience this morning, continuing on in our Win the Moment sermon series. Acts 14, verses 19 through 20. This is what it says. Then some Jews came from Antioch and Iconium and won the crowd over. They stoned Paul and dragged him outside the city, thinking he was dead. But after the disciples had gathered around him, he got up and went back into the city. The next day, he and Barnabas left for Derbe. Thomas Edison is the inventor of the light bulb. He failed 10,000 times before perfecting the electric light bulb. Someone asked him once, "Mr. Edison, do you feel like a failure?" To which he replied, "I have not failed. I have just found 10,000 ways that don't work." What if he had stopped at attempt 5,000? It's possible that we would never have heard the name Thomas Edison. Resilience is the ability to recover and come back at the same level or even stronger. We will never learn to win if we cannot handle failure. We need to learn to fall forward by making amends, repenting if necessary, saying I'm sorry, or getting help in adversity. The Apostle Paul experienced the exhilaration of miracles and the pain of resistance. The key to a successful mission isn't always extraordinary talent. There are many people with tremendous gifts and capabilities. Winning people are not always the most gifted. In the midst of adversity, what your knowledge isn't, or what capabilities that you have, isn't the most important thing. Blessed are those who are able to persevere through adversity. What we know doesn't matter if we don't practice resilience. The opportunity to recover is the ability to be rebuilt into someone who is more complete. That's what God does in our lives by working resilience in us through His grace. Practice resilience to win the moment. So let's see what Scripture has to say about resilience. First, in verse 19, notice with me that rocks will fly. In verse 19, there's a group of Jews that came from Antioch and Iconium and won the crowd over, Scripture tells us. They stoned Paul and dragged him outside the city thinking that he was dead. We have this idea that if we give our lives to Christ, that comfort will come along with it, that everything will go well. If we make the right decisions, that things will always take place as we want them to. Paul was a church planting missionary, an inspired writer of the New Testament. If anyone deserved health and wealth, it would have been Paul. He devoted himself passionately and fully to the Lord and his work. He ordered his life well. He loved Christ. He was faithful in his prayers and going out and doing missionary work, church planting. Yet in spite of all he did for Christ, he didn't expect Christ to give him the whole world. The meaningful road isn't always easy or safe. While preaching the gospel, some problems didn't just magically go away. There was a group who came from other areas who were motivated by hearing Paul. They were in conflict with him. They chased him down. They had planned to stone him. We read earlier in chapter 14, verse 5, yet Paul slipped away. So they planned in the past to stone him, and now they have found him. They turned the crowd against him that was listening intently to him, an audience that actually was hanging on his every word, turned against Paul due to the influence of these bullies. If you're a believer, if you give your heart to Christ, that doesn't mean that there will not be times in your life that you have to stare down bullies. Bullies are everywhere, and sometimes they just won't leave us alone. Now they chased after Paul, incited the crowd, and took action against him. Adversity will catch up with us. If you have an opinion, if you have a voice, if you have a belief that you hold close to your heart, there will be conflict because someone else will have a different opinion than you. Here is a lesson to learn. You can't make everyone happy and be happy with yourself. If you compromise yourself, your values and your faith to please others, you're giving away that of yourself that is the most essential to you. You're surrendering it, and how can we ever be pleased in our conscience if we give away that which is most essential to ourselves? Stones begin to fly at Paul. To stone in this time was literally to pelt with rocks for the purpose of an execution. Normally, the victim was thrown off a cliff and the rocks began to fly. Not in this circumstance. They might have thrown him off of something in the city, but here they are pelting him with rocks. The stones will fly. Hurting, broken, judgmental people, bullies, walk around with stones in their hands, looking for an opportunity to sling them at someone else who has a different opinion. With every rock they threw at Paul, they imposed a will to stop on him. They wanted to stop this man, dead in his tracks, literally. Stone after stone, they hurled at him to the point that he collapsed to the ground like a dead man. This wasn't enough for the shameful mob of bullies. They drug him on the ground out of the city. Scripture says, they thought that Paul was dead. Some bullies will not stop until they have completely shut you down. And here they are, treating the author of most of the New Testament like trash. Don't be shocked when the rocks start flying against you. Verse 22 of our passage says that we must go through many trials and troubles to enter the kingdom of God. There is no easy path to maturity in Christ. The stones will fly sometimes. To believe is to take an opinion. It's to take a stand. And how would we not want to live any other way than to be true to our faith and follow through on our beliefs? Don't let suffering or the bullies or even the voice of your own condemnation stop you from winning the moment. Picture this with me. You've worked hard all day long. You hear a cry for help from the back room. You open the door as you're coming home from work. And in the back room, you hear a cry for help. So you walk back, and as you get closer to the back of your house, you see a friend of yours laying on the ground saying, "Help me. I've fallen. I'm hurt." So what question do you ask at that moment? Do you ask, "Why did you fall? Was it your fault?" You blame them and say, "I know what happened. You fell because you tripped over something." Or, "What happened?" I would ask the question, why is this person in my house? First to start with. But here it is. When someone is on the ground, the reason doesn't matter. It's not always in our place to judge why someone has fallen. The most important need is to get back up again. Help your friend up. Or, potentially, let's bring this closer to home. Help yourself back up by calling on the name of God for inspiration, for power, for the Holy Spirit. Yes, there are bullies in the world. Yes, there are resisting forces that come against us. But don't stay down. Rocks will fly. But we must rise up in the power of God. So look with me at verse 20. There Paul is laying on the ground like a dead man, hit and pelted with rock after rock. I'm wondering if he didn't think of Stephen while he was being stoned. Paul could have thought that this was his last moment, that he was getting ready to go see the Lord. And then in verse 20, there he is, laying on the ground, bruised, eyes probably swollen shut, bloodied from being hit with all of the rocks. And I'm wondering if his eye just cracked open just a little bit. And there around him, his first sight would have been the image of the church standing around him. There are his friends. There are the disciples that are there gathered around him, praying for him. Praying for their fallen friend, for their persecuted preacher in this circumstance. Literally sharing the love and grace of God with him. After flying rocks, when we've been knocked down, that's when we need the right people to gather around us. We need to be in fellowship with people that love us. Resilience is more effective with a team of the right people around us. Sometimes you need a hand to get back up off the ground. If you've been hit hard enough, you need a hand, a holy hand from someone who loves. And sometimes we've got to reach out for it. But I challenge you, as you lay on the ground because you've fallen emotionally, spiritually, or you're discouraged, reach out. Let someone put their hand in yours. And I want to challenge you even further. Be the reason for someone else's resilience. Be the reason that someone else says, if he got through it, I can get through it. With this friend in my corner, I can get up again. You see, Paul responded to this moment because the church was with him as a group, loving one another, praying. Our unity helps one another to rise up. The best prayers cause action, and this prayer brought the disciples together. After this tragedy, they gathered around him. And then here's my favorite three words in verse 20. Actually, I should say I've got six words that I love in verse 20. But these are the first three. He got up. He was knocked down, but now physically, and I would say also spiritually, not as a result of his own sin, but because of his love for Christ, he was persecuted. And now through the power of Christ and the prayers of the church, this man who had been stoned and left for dead got up. 2 Corinthians 11:25. You can write this one down. 2 Corinthians 11:25. Paul says, once I was pelted with stones. He remembers this moment. It's fresh in his heart and his memory as he's writing to the Corinthians. Here's another reference. 2 Corinthians 4:9. I love this. Struck down, but not destroyed. J.B. Phillips says this in 2 Corinthians 4:9. J.B. Phillips, we may be knocked down, but we are not knocked out. He was knocked down, but he got up. He was bruised and broken by the stones and left for dead, but he got up. You see, what really matters in life is not how many times you fall down. It matters how many times you get up. The mob of bullies had beaten him to the point that they thought this was over and they left. But you know who didn't give up on Paul? The church didn't give up on him. They believed, and he got up. Hit your knees. Pray for other believers. Rather than being a part of the mob that throws the stones at someone, let's hit our knees in prayer and love people. Rising up is a work of spiritual power. Let's be a part of new life and rising up and new futures in people's lives. Resilience. I believe that if Paul wasn't a praying man, this could have been the end of his work, and we would have never heard of him potentially. Not only did Paul get up, and I said I had three more words that I loved in this verse. He got up, he went back. This is the full work of resilience. If you've fallen down, get back up and go back. Get up, go back. 2 Corinthians 4:10 says this. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. Paul is saying, in essence, I've been broken. I've been persecuted. But the life and the power of the Holy Spirit, the life of Jesus, is active in me. I didn't know this, but there's an art in Japan that's specifically responsible for repairing broken pottery. I won't pronounce the word for it to you this morning. But when a vase, for instance, falls to the ground and gets broken, these artists will take it and bind it back together with gold in some circumstances. And every imperfection from the brokenness is highlighted with gold. Whenever I've broken a cup, a vase, or a piece of pottery, I've used super glue on it. I don't know about you. Or some type of epoxy-based solution. But here's the beautiful thing about brokenness. When broken pieces are put back together with epoxy or even gold, the addition of other elements can make it stronger than it was. When we get broken, Christ is our healer. And whatever Jesus heals, Jesus strengthens. If you are broken, it's time to come back stronger. Rocks will fly, rise up, then rethink your life. Hear these words at the end of verse 20. The first phrase, the next day. Hear that in your heart. When we're down, sometimes we don't think that there is a next day. But resilience makes a next day possible. Resilience gives you the opportunity of having a new day. If we stay down on the ground, wallowing in the dust of our failure, or in Paul's case, in the dust of adversity and the pain of persecution, there is no new day. Don't stay stuck in yesterday, the pain of yesterday. When there is a new day with beauty, glory, and joy, but it only happens if we go on to the next day. There's a new day for the resilient. Rejoice. It's coming. You may be broken, knocked down, but you're not knocked out. The next day is coming. See, here's the thing that we see over and over again in the book of Acts. Difficult, negative circumstances come the way of the church, and it looks like the mission will not go on. But the promise of God's word is still true. The gates of hell will not prevail against the church. The Holy Spirit can change the atmosphere and direction of the wind. You might have been sailing against the wind into a storm, but God can masterfully change the direction of our lives. So here is a change of direction. Paul may have went back into the city, but he went on after he went back into the city. He didn't stay in the place where he was rejected. There are some things in life you can't change. Some people will never listen. You might have been sent to plant a seed in their life, and that's all. So here Paul changes direction. Something different happens to us internally when we suffer through adversity and we do it with the right spirit and the right heart. The person before the trial is remarkably different than the person we become after the trial. There's a story behind every scar. Every wound, every hurt, every broken moment. All of those marks on our soul are a story to tell. Paul would say in Galatians 6, I believe it is, I bear in my body the marks of Jesus Christ. Wounds have a story. And they proclaim a message of the reason why we were wounded. The greatest act of resilience in the history of the world and for all eternity is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Christ Jesus lived a sinless life. He preached the kingdom of God, healed the blind, touched the outcast. Yet out of sheer spite, the rulers of this world crucified him. He was laid on a cold day in a cold tomb there in a place of death, a place where life's end. Yet his suffering gave way to victory. The lamb who was slain got up again. Jesus was powered by the Holy Spirit in a powerful work of resilience and rose again. And then he appeared to the disciples, and what did he say to them? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I, myself. Touch me. Luke 24, 39 through 40. Or this is a good one here. John 20, verse 27, he turns to doubting Thomas and he says, put your finger here, see my hands, and put out your hand, place it on my side. Do not believe, but believe. And then this all culminates in Revelation 5, verse 6, where John says, then I saw a lamb looking as if it had been slain, standing at the center of the throne, encircled by the four living creatures and the elders. The lamb had seven eyes and seven horns and seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. catch this, in the center of the throne room of heaven, there is a lamb who looks as if he was slain. Jesus, I believe, will still have his scars in heaven. The scars of Jesus tell a different story. They tell the gospel of resilience, that God is able to bring people back from wherever they were. So no matter where you are today, no matter how bad you've fallen, whether you're down in the dirt, due to adversity, due to a failure, you can rise up again today, come back, recover, maybe even stronger than you've ever been before. Adversity will come our way. Rise up and rethink your direction. Let's pray together today. Holy Spirit, we call on the name of Jesus. Father, we pray for an anointing of healing. We confess our need for the grace of God. Left to ourselves, we lose confidence and we can get discouraged. We have fallen in many ways, Lord. We seek for your forgiveness, those of us that need it. But Lord God, we also know that our fall isn't final if you touch us. And then there are those others that might be discouraged because of persecution that has taken place in their lives. God, we pray that they would find a second wind. Lord, raise us up. Send us in the right direction and show us your ways. It's in the name of Christ we pray. Amen.